let's just, you know, level set. Tell me a little about Veenome, because, you know, from the video genome and sort of how your product and technology's matured, I'd like, give me a little bit of a retrospective and then where you are in a point in time.
Yeah, so basically our whole premise is, you know, detect and produce content data, right? So all around the video, whether it's the category of the video, could be, you know, brand safety of the video, how big the players are, how many video players there are, this issue of inventory type that I described earlier, the in-banner and stream and game. So just detecting all these kinds of attributes and then providing them in large quantities to, you know, all sides of the market, sell side, buy side, for different reasons. The business buckets are, I'd say there are three. One is probably the most basic, which is just auditing, which is literally just helping exchanges and ad networks understand more about what their content is and how it's doing and how their publishers are doing.
So that's, I would say it's also like QA, right?
Yeah.
Making sure that what they've got coming in the pipes is actually sellable and viable.
Right, and there's a challenge with that side of the business that I'll talk about in a sec, but the other two are blocking, so detecting things either like within the traditional realm of video that's offensive or, you know, alcohol, drugs, these kinds of things, but also things with their avoidance categories, which are basically like the idea that Goldman Sachs doesn't want to run on financial disaster news, right? And so there's stuff that isn't actually offensive, but it's things that certain brands don't want to run on.
Yep.
And the third is targeting. So trying to match the, you know, pre-roll content to the video content and then seeing what happens as a result. So this year we have some results from that targeting aspect, but I did want to mention quickly on the auditing side, the challenge that we face and the reason why I was sort of talking in from the perspective of saying, look, the audience approach sort of allows for a lot of funky stuff to go on at the content level. So one of the challenges we have is that when we'll do a big audit for an ad network and they don't like what they see, it's tricky because you're sort of selling something that says, hey, you know, your pants are halfway down. And so it's tricky. So you kind of have to do a little bit of creative marketing to figure out how you want to call certain things and things like that. So it's interesting just because the auditing business has been, there's been a lot of one-offs, because I think as we deliver audits to customers, if they don't necessarily like what the audits say, they don't want to come back and continue to give us business.
So this is sort of an interesting issue that I've always thought, because we've been talking a lot about the construct between supply and demand side, right? And sort of buy, sell side, et cetera, in our conversations the last 2 days. So when we talk about auditing and viewability or fraud, you know, what's your perspective on the marketplace, given that you're selling to both, that, you know, at a point in time and then eventually where the market settles out, whose responsibility is that to bear that cost?
Yeah, I mean, I think it starts with where that, like how the inventory gets placed, right? So there's sort of two big buckets of stuff that we see on the content side in terms of fraud. I mean, obviously there's non-human traffic, that's sort of a separate issue. I won't really touch on that, but if you look at kind of the generally when we're seeing stuff that isn't viewable or we're seeing a lot of this in banner stuff, there's sort of two sources. One is the publisher placing it themselves, or it's like a big syndication aggregation machine just like slapping a single video on, you know, 1,000 different pages of the same site.
Right.
And it's hard to say like who actually is at fault in that scenario,
but it's not about fault. I guess my question is like, should the publisher bear the responsibility, because there's so much bad behavior and it's rampant in our industry, of the cost of a third party like yourself to come in and make
sure I see what you're saying.
They're on their best behavior, or is it an incremental cost of buying the media, which then would result in a reduction of revenue? So it's either like, does it, you know, for a publisher, does it affect your revenue or does it affect your margin?
So the way the market's played out, it actually winds up being mostly the ad networks that pay the cost, mm-hmm. because they're the ones that are generally profiting from the amount of inventory that's out there, right? So if you're an ad network and you have, you know, 10,000 publishers that you work with, you wind up benefiting the most from a proliferation of lots of inventory. So they're bearing it now. It's a little tricky for a small company like us to sell into a publisher just because they get hit by so many vendors. So part of those ways in which we do hit them is we actually work through like channel partners. So last year we signed like Double Verify and work with Innovid, and we have a few other verification providers that we also work with. But basically our data gets passed through kind of white labeled so that they don't have to work with another vendor. So
it is
getting to publishers.
An end-to-end solution, if you will.
Yeah, it is getting to publishers. We're not directly selling to them, and it's really just because of the idea of like vendor consolidation, and people don't want to work with like a point solution for just for video.
So let's talk about this, because I know, I mean, I guess it has a lot to do with fraud and viewability and everything. Like, what is the role of an ad network in video, right? And I mean, put premium aside, because no, you know, premium video publisher really has to rely on an ad network in many, in some regards, right? They may choose to.
Yeah, they may.
Right, so for syndicated content or whatever. But if they're going to a network, they're going to an AOL, you know, or et cetera. But if we talk about kind of that, as to use Jen's sort of vernacular, mid-tail, long-tail, right? What is the role of an ad network? I mean, are they just aggregating and then they're typically relying on programmatic as the fulfillment or a direct sales channel? Like, I mean, you know, there are not a lot of video at network ad sales guys. I mean, there's, you know, Yumi, a couple big ones left. But, you know, what role and value do they play in the ecosystem right now?
I mean, I think they're getting, mostly they're getting volume, right? Like they're gathering together a bunch of disparate sources that wouldn't really be effective on their own to run a campaign, and collecting them and making them useful for larger campaigns. Now, in that process, you wind up with a lot of fraud and funky stuff. Like that inventory type isn't actually fraud, but it's
right.
Definitely not what the advertisers are thinking they're getting. What they're getting is volume. When there's long tail means there's 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 little publishers that they're all clumping together and saying, well, you know, we're going to run on these 1,000 publishers, and there's enough people here to run 30 million impressions.
I mean, do you think, especially because if we look at programmatic as we've defined it, if we look at automation, not programmatic, if we look at automation of the sort of sales fulfillment, right? So the supply side platform for video, do guys like SpotX, et cetera, eventually displace the ad networks? Is there any value for them? Because then you can inherently, as part of, you know, the actual transaction, ensure that one of the decision points in the workflow is viewability, is the auditing process. You know, guys like you come in, and that's a stopgap that no one actually has to make sure that everyone's on their best behavior. It's kind of part of the fulfillment chain.
Yeah, I mean, if you're asking sort of, do I think that like exchanges and programmatic is sort of the way that I think it will move and away from traditional
just
ad networks?
Just more automation.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I think that everyone would say that, and every traditional ad network is trying to build as much as they can of some kind of exchange or some sort of programmatic. Everybody's trying to do something more automated than what they did before, right? And
well, I'm asking because, Kevin, what I'm hearing from you is that a publisher or an owner aggregator of content may have, you know, the insights and information about how their media, the quality and caliber of their media and how it's performing from parties like Veenome, but that whether or not they actually choose to disclose it or use it is a different story. So it's always going to be incumbent upon the buy side to actually make sure that these guys are doing that.
Yes.
So to me, like the, you know, I guess why I'm asking for your perspective on how the market unfolds, because it feels like that's a short-term gain.
Yeah, I think, I mean, ultimately, it's interesting. So it feels to me like when we sell, it feels to me like there's sort of this huge kind of everything on the sell side is sort of they want the data that the kind of data that we produce or others like us produce, but they're sort of scared that it might, you know, either to over-segment things and drop a bunch out that they don't think is good. I think there's a lot more fear than reality there. I think that the reality is some will be priced higher, some will be priced lower, but that whole engine, except from the brand, is sort of like a little bit scared of getting the data. The brand actually really wants it. And like we've seen all sorts of media that's come out that the buy side actually wants it. We're just starting to actually directly deliver the information to those brands. And I think you'll see more of that where they're basically just taking control of the data stream that they're getting and they're actually getting the reporting from us. Whereas 2 years ago, we couldn't even start a conversation with them. So I do think that the actual buyer mm-hmm. is going to get more information than they're getting before. And I think that ultimately, once they have it, then the rest everyone else has to have it. So I do think that sort of shifting into that customer will actually be the buyer, whereas 2 years ago, all our business was on the sell side.
Okay. So just to sort of wrap it, I mean, I would love your forward-looking perspective on, you know, the next 12 months. Like, the large endemic and systemic issues of viewability and fraud and, you know, some of the stuff that you're auditing, right? Like the quality or caliber of the, is it in banner, et cetera?
Right.
I mean, where does that play out at the end of 2015, right? I mean,
yeah.
Is it, do we as an industry make, you know, gross sort of broad brushstroke decisions about, you know, every buy actually on the buy side will use these third party partners, et cetera? Like, how does it all play out in 12 months?
I think so. I mean, I think last year, everyone's priority in terms of like in the boat of fraud or analytics was viewability, right? Everyone wanted to make sure that their ads are being viewed, and there's just a whole laundry list of other things behind. Like that's not that problem. Solving that problem doesn't solve the rest of the. There's a whole bunch of other issues with inventory and the way it's packaged and presented and reported that still exist. So I don't think it's like near being solved. I think that things are going to tend to get solved one by one, and that's at least, you know, like I said, being out there selling it, people have like one priority that they're doing, and then they go on to the next one. And so like, I actually think that viewability is people are going to kind of finish whatever they were doing or partnering or building. They're going to kind of finish that this year, and then they're going to start working on a lot of these other issues. Some of it might be like non-human traffic. Some of it's going to be like I was describing, inventory type. Mm-hmm. And I think they're going to kind of work down the list. And I think the next few are, like I said, are inventory type, obviously non-human traffic.
Which we call fraud typically.
Yeah. And then, well, I mean, fraud is a big, a big group.
But I just think when we talk about viewability and fraud, and we typically use them together. So yeah. I just think it's important.
Yeah.
Typically it's non-human traffic and how the video is being rendered
screen. And then I think there's another interesting one, which is a case we've seen a lot recently, which is a little bit more fringe, but basically the idea that you have one site running a single video on every page of their site. And so I think the ratio, there's an important factor of quality, which is the ratio of sort of impressions to a number of videos.
Right.
Can be literally one video to 10 million impressions on a site. And I think those kinds of quality measures that are a little more advanced, people start to dig into those when they get through the big ones, like you said, viewability, fraud.
Right. These are the oh shit moments, if you will.
Yes.
Okay. Awesome. Thanks, Kevin. Thank you.